Now look who we got ourselves here.
Here you are, lemonade.
Drink that, boy.
Another one? On his tab?
In 2007, Takashi Okazaki created Afro Samurai. It was inspired by Okazaki's love of soul, hip-hop music, and American media. To this day, Afro Samurai is considered one of the best animated series of all time, but mostly for Okazaki's design work and Samuel L. Jackson's voice acting. Critics have said Okazaki doesn't have a head for storytelling, that Afro Samurai is hardly a complex story, and that it's mostly incomprehensible scribbles that favor style over substance. To the average anime fan, these critiques are true and echoed by most of them.
If it seems like I'm dwelling on the behind-the-scenes stuff for the show and not actually talking about the show itself, it's because, well, Afro Samurai is kind of, how do I put this? You know how people say that some things are style over substance? Well, for Afro Samurai, the style is the substance.
However, I'm not an anime fan, and I do think the opinions are fair, but they don't tell the whole truth. Afro Samurai isn't supposed to be watched as an anime, and it's not a story about the historical figure Yasuke.
Well then, why not talk about the real Afro Samurai? Who? Yasuke, retainer to Oda Nobunaga. Though I like to refer to him as the Obsidian Samurai, cause dang if he wouldn't have earned that title.
So, what's this guy about?
Well, little is actually known about Yasuke before his arrival to Japan. Most people theorize that he was a slave from Mozambique, but others say he could have come from Ethiopia, Zimbabwe, Southern Sudan, or even Portuguese born into slavery.
It's more of a blaxploitation or gangster film, like Black Dynamite.
See where I'm coming from, you die,
Black Dynamite!
Or Menace to Society.
What the fuck you say about my mom?
I don't want any trouble with that. Get out!
You're talking shit.
I'm gonna tell my cousin this motherfucker. You got something to say.
Understanding Afro Samurai's genre is essential to understanding its story of inner-city blues and the inescapable cycle of violence that many poverty-stricken minorities find themselves trapped in. Let's look at the setting and atmosphere. Afro Samurai takes place in a feudal yet futuristic Japan. Characters tote swords, guns, kimonos, cell phones, and cybernetic body parts. Afro Samurai's world should be interpreted as inner city America. Sure, they enjoy amenities like iPhones and the Second Amendment, but they're lagging behind in social structures. Like feudal Japan, the American ghetto features a government with weak involvement and inhabitants fighting for more land, more wealth, and above all, more power.
Trying to picture Mr. Jefferson hustling on these streets.
Seeing you broom up in the black Saab, the gold BBSs, man. I said, damn, this nigga's really making this money. He's really making money, man. You understand?
Listen, hey, it ain't just about the money. It's not. You know what it's about, man? It's about fucking those skeezers like that right there. It's about driving these fly-ass cars. And it's definitely about never dressing like a nigga like you, man.
Okay, man.
Come on, man. Let's go be stars up in this joint, all right?
Afro Samurai's storyline shines more light on this allegory. In Okazaki's Japan, there's a legend.
Ma'am?
Yeah?
Why is everyone after this Afro Samurai?
You don't know? You really must be from out of town. We got ourselves a legend around here.
A legend?
Look, two ancient headbands. Number one and number two. If you have the number one, you're like a god. Nobody can touch you. Except he who wears number two. The trouble with that is...
The trouble with that is that anyone in the world can challenge him.
Clever boy.
This is eerily similar to the real-life fable of glory claimed to be found in gang life in impoverished America.
One night they were out in the streets celebrating this man who had just made his way back from El Salvador. Nelson, remember him? He had respect, power, and pride. Everything that I didn't have. I wonder what it would be like to be him, to be revered in your own neighborhood. That night I made a decision. I was 14 years old, and I was going to join MS-13.
At the beginning of the series, Afro's father is the owner of the number one headband. Then he's challenged by a man named Justice.
Remember me, number one. I've been waiting a very long time for this.
I know, but it all ends here.
Justice beheads Afro's father and tells a young Afro who just witnessed to
challenge me when you're ready to duel a god.
The name Justice is what makes the parallel to real life more obvious. It's an exaggeration, but it's very real. Justice is undoubtedly a representation of the police and justice system, who seize control of the inner city through violence, just like the samurai seize control in feudal Japan. After this interaction, Justice retires to hiding, as the police tend to do in the inner city, leaving our young protagonist Afro fatherless, with a number two headband, and a target on his back. Afro is quickly assaulted and robbed of the headband. He's then found and adopted by a gang of up-and-coming warriors who teach him how to properly wield a blade. If you're following me, you're realizing Afro Samurai is identical to the stories of the ghetto in your favorite gangster film. With PTSD from watching his father die and his own assault, Afro is prone to violence. Using his newfound skills, Afro sneaks out every night to hunt for the number two headband. By the time Afro is a teen, he learns that the man who adopted him holds the headband. Ruled only by his lust for revenge, Afro kills his adopted father without remorse.
Chosen your path.
Afro! No! Don't!
Which leaves his new family fatherless with the same scars as himself. Many kids in the inner city lose their parents to the justice system or to violence. This causes them to join the race for the number two headband, traumatizing other youth and fueling a never-ending cycle of violence. Like Afro, they become the very thing they hate. In chasing revenge, they become street justice. In the next stretch of Afro Samurai, the story becomes straightforward, beat the next guy. And maybe this is where most anime fans get lost or disinterested. But Okazaki keeps the allegories and symbolism going. They're just hidden in the details. Like when Afro meets the number two guardian, Ninja Ninja, who could represent a warped conscience found in gangsters.
Yo, Afro! That was off the chain! Cold-blooded!
Damn, motherfucker!
Excuse me for probing, but what you just did back there, was it absolutely necessary?
I'm beginning to wonder if you got any feeling for human life left in you at all.
Nope.
Tom. Hey, 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 if you don't stop dissing me, I'm gonna stop following your brutal ass around. Then who's gonna watch your back?
Or when Afro gets injured and has to take refuge at Okiku's house, who then tries to set him up and have him killed by the MP7 hitmen.
Forgive me, I've become a ninja of the MP7 clan. I've been siphoning your memories to copy your sword skills, but I can't do it anymore. To me, you're still that same boy from those wonderful times so long ago.
Get out of my way.
In the inner city, that's a real occurrence, like Gucci Mane's story.
Accounts vary widely about what exactly happened, but the version we heard from one source is that Gucci took home a girl from a club and was in the process of bedding her when four armed men broke into the house and began pistol whipping him. It was a setup. Before they could take his chain, however, Gucci got his hands on one of the guns and fired nude at his assailants, killing one of them and sending the rest fleeing in terror. Legend has it Guwa buried the dead man in the woods behind a middle school and found a new girl to finish the night with.
Even the MP7 are an allegory. They're religious men who sport Southern Baptist accents.
Surged with the skills of number two, where could you find such a man?
Not a man, rather a thing.
Explain more, brother one.
Obviously a nod to the ever-present Christian community who also vie for power in the inner city.
To those critics that say that a preacher should not be living a life of luxury, what is your response to that?
They're wrong.
Over the years, the Christian community has become corrupt, and pastors are just New Age feudal emperors. The MP7 represent that. They're surrounded by provocative women.
First of all, fuck you. Okay, second of all, you have an issue with me being on a picture with a beautiful black woman. Let me set the record straight. I am a pastor, first of all, that feeds the hungry. I'm a pastor that has a girls, a boys, and a woman's mentoring program. I teach empowerment on a daily basis. Yes, I'm a pastor that likes pussy. Can I say it again? I like pussy.
Order hits and want the number one headband to become God themselves. An even smaller detail people may not pay attention to is when Afro mentions he's headed east to find justice.
May I ask where you're traveling to, mighty samurai?
East.
East.
Typically, the east side of cities are more violent and impoverished. After a few duels with himself,
he's trying to copy you! Hold up! That is you!
His childhood friend, and the death of Ninja Ninja, Afro finally confronts and kills Justice. Or so he thought. Because as we all know, the justice system will never suffer a loss, and it'll never die out. Afro claims his new headband and becomes the new number one. In Afro Samurai, Resurrection, the sequel to Afro Samurai, we see that Afro has left the life of cruelty behind him, as gangsters tend to do after they've grown old and wise. Until Afro is lured back into the game by Gino and his sister Sio, who still want revenge for Afro killing their father.
Your father will suffer the punishment for your sins. Unless you find the number two headband and try to stop me.
A storyline that's present in every gangster story. Along the way, Afro kills many more men, including Shikigoru, who wants the number one headband to put an end to the cyclical violence. In the finale of the series, Afro must fight a clone of his father, and of course he's reluctant at first. And until he hears the voice of his true father, urging him to kill the clone so his soul may rest.
Forgive me. You are not my father. My father died a long time ago.
Finally, Afro has completed his cycle of inner city blues. He's come to terms with his father's death and Justice's motives. As he heads back into hiding, Afro runs into Kitaru, Shikigoru's son. Afro hands him the number 2 headband in a scene reminiscent of the scene with him and Justice. The cycle of violence continues. Before the film ends, it cuts to Justice, alluding to the fact that he's still alive, and neither feudal Japan nor the inner city will ever escape him. Afro's story has ended, but Kitaru's has just begun. Afro realizes he's become the very thing that he hated, and perhaps his father initiated the same disarray with Justice. As for us viewers, we've realized that Afro Samurai has nothing to do with anime, feudal Japan, headbands, or Yasuke. It's about the complex story of inner city America.
From the look on your face, I'd say you had a hell of a rough day. You knew this, didn't you? You knew it don't ever end. I do, Afro Samurai. I won't say nothing. I did more. But you know.
This is Alex from Pocketbook Philosophy. If you enjoyed the video, let me know in the comments or leave a like. If you're feeling especially moved, maybe share it with a friend or two. I'm getting into the habit of releasing a new video every Saturday, and I am open to requests. But, as always, thanks for watching, and until next time, have a great day.